Sunday, we studied the beautiful verse 24 and the following two or three verses where this idea of the unity of everything was expressed. Verse 24 had said, Brahmarpanam, Brahmahavi, Brahmatnav, ब्रह्मणाहुतं ब्रह्मैव तेन गंतव्यं ब्रह्मकर्म समाधिना एवरीथिंग इज ब्रह्मन ऑफ द नेचर ऑफ प्योर कॉन्शियसनेस एंड दैट आइडिया इज एक्सप्रेस्ड हियर द वन हु मेक्स सैक्रिफाइस इज ब्रह्मन द थिंग विच इज यूज्ड फॉर सैक्रिफाइस इज ब्रह्मन द फायर इज ब्रह्मन द एक्ट इज ब्रह्मन The result also is Brahman. That is the nature of this teaching. Everything is Brahman. Brahmatmanam, Brahmahavi, Brahmatnav, Brahmanahutam, Brahmaivatena Gantavyam, Brahmakarma Samadhina. The concept of unity behind all this diversity. In the solar system, as I said earlier, solar radiation is everything. Similarly, the world as a whole, Brahman of the nature of pure consciousness, is everything. The food that we take, the digestive power within us, the coal, the cloth, all these are nothing but various modifications of solar radiation. So in a wider context, taking the universe as a whole, Brahman is everything. That concept is invoked in this shloka. Brahma Atmanam, Brahma Havik, Brahma Atnav, Brahma Nahudam, Brahma Ivatena Dantavyam, Brahma Karma Samadhina. After that, several ideas of sacrifices were mentioned in the succeeding two, three verses, saying, We worship, some people worship gods, deities, similarly also yajnam neva upajushyati, Brahma now, the fire which is Brahman, you offer the thing called offering is put in the fire. This is also yajna. In all these verses, Sri Krishna is giving a spiritual and ethical orientation to the concept of yajna. Yajna is originally a ritual. You have it in the Vedic religion. You have it in Judaism. You have it in Christianity. In all these religions, the concept of yajna is there. In the Gita also it is mentioned. But Krishna gives a spiritual and philosophical orientation, ethical orientation to this concept of yajna. So, when we sotrari indriyani anye samyama atyashi yukhati, whatever sensory energies we have, we sacrifice them into the fire of self-control. So, self-control is treated as fire into which we put all these sensory impulses to purify them, to refine them, to develop character. Similarly, shabda, hearing, touch, all these various senses also, indriyatmishu, we sacrifice them in the fire of the sensory system. Sensory energy is a fire into which all these sensory capacities are sacrificed. Similarly, all the sensory activities, सर्ग इंद्रिय कर्म सर्वाणि इंद्रिय कर्माणि व्हाट वी डू विद देम ऑल दी सेंसरी एक्टिविटीज प्राण कर्माणि चापरे एज वेल एज अवर अदर बायो एनर्जीज विद इन द सिस्टम ऑल दिस आत्म संयम आज्ञाओं इसे योग आज्ञाओं we sacrifice them in the fire lit by our yoga. Yoga control is called fire. Into that we sacrifice all these sensory energies. These are all things we do every day, less or more. So yoga is, yajna is going on all the time. Krishna wants to say, when you control your anger, what do? You burn your anger in your knowledge, in your discrimination. Similarly, the various functionings of the body are also treated as practicing yajna. The fire is there and the various items are there. They are put into the fire and burned out. That is all what we do in yajna. You light a fire, pour some butter into it. That is called ordinary type of yajna. That yajna is going on in day-to-day life, controlling the senses, controlling the mind, raising life to higher levels of expression. All these are methods by which we achieve spiritual development. And these are all yajna. Then he referred to various types of yajna. The verse 27, which we are to study today from this slogan onwards, said sarvani indriya karmani prana karmani chakare atma samyama yoga asnav yuhvati jnana deepite. All kinds of sensory actions and energies and the vital functions of the body, these are all put in the fire of self-control and they are burned away. That's how we develop higher character. Self-control is needed for all higher character. So atma samyama, self-discipline, self-control, that is called a yoga agni, the fire of yoga. Wherever there is a little control of sensory impulses, you are already developing the fire of yoga. That fire of yoga burns away that tendency that takes us in the wrong direction. In this way, life is a continuous struggle and it is compared to fire sacrifice. Atma sambhima yoga now yuhvati a sacrifice there. What kind of fire? Jnana deepite. Here the fire is lit by jnana, knowledge, wisdom. It is wisdom that tells us that we should not yield to every sensory impulse. As a human being, we have to control these sensory impulses. Without that, there is no human development. In animals, there is no sensory control. Nature has implanted in them various sensory impulses, and these impulses find automatic expression. But in a human child, we expect some sort of control of these impulses, just like toilet training for children. No animal has got toilet training, but a human child has toilet training. Similarly, other types of training, so that it may become really a human child fit for a human society. But in all these things, Krishna sees sacrifice going on. Jnana deepite, knowledge and discrimination is the fire. That lights the fire in which you sacrifice these sensory impulses, thus carry their energy to higher forms of expression. These are beautiful ideas. All our impulses need a good deal of refining, a good deal of purification, to make them human in their operation. That is the way of character development, and therefore in all these activities we are engaging ourselves In a spiritual pursuit, spirituality begins in our day-to-day life itself and not something for a special Sunday or a sacred day. That is where Gita brings religion into life itself. Life itself is religion, says Swami Vivekananda. Because we have the spiritual element within us, we are trying to manifest it. For that we need some of these disciplines of the body-mind complex. Therefore, life itself is religion. Atma samyama yoga now. Then, the next shloka, 28. You find various types of yajnas. And Krishna is telling that between material yajnas and mental and spiritual yajnas, the latter are more important, more significant. These are the yajnas. Dravya yajna tatha tapo yajna yoga yajna tatha pare svadhyaya jnana yajnascha yadaya samshita vrataha. Says, others again offer wealth, austerity and yoga as sacrifice, while still others of self-restraint and rigid vows, they offer study of the scriptures and knowledge as sacrifice. Dravya yajna. Dravya is actually wealth. Dravya yajna. Tapo yajna. Austerity. Tapas is austerity. Yoga yajna. Yoga. That is also self-restraint. Tathapare. These are some people's way of yajna. Others, svadhyaya. Study of elevating books, sacred books. Jnana yajna. The knowledge of sacrifice. Yataya samshita vrataha. Those who have self-control, rigid in their vows, they engage themselves in this type of sacrifice. So we are taking sacrifice from something external to something internal. Life itself is a great sacrifice. So 28 verse refer to these various types of sacrifices. Then finally, in the next verse, 29. Apane jihvati pranam, prane apanam tathapare, pranapana gati rudhva, pranayama parayanaha. This is pranayama, the control of breath. That is also compared to a yajna or a sacrifice. How? Some offer as sacrifice the outgoing breath into the ingoing breath. This is the way of pranayama. You breathe in, you breathe out. That is a type of sacrifice. Then the incoming into the outgoing, the opposite direction. Then stopping the course of the incoming on the outgoing. That is the middle section of pranayama. First you breathe in, then hold it for some time. Vechaka, kumbha. This is the kumbhaka, the controlling of the breath within. That also is a type of sacrifice. Constantly practicing the regulation of the vital energy. All this is for regulating the vital energy that is in the system, the prana or the bioenergy that we have. By controlling the breathing apparatus, we are able to control the vital energy functioning in the system. That is the principle of pranayama. There also, Krishna sees the spirit of sacrifice, while others, yet of regulated food, offer in the pranas the functions of the pranas. Food that we take, and food has to be digested. There is prana functioning there. So, the next type of sacrifice is what is said, apare, apare niyataharaha. They regulate their food, some people. Pranan praneshu jukvati. Prana is sacrificed into prana. That is what we do when we do food, taking food into the system. So these are the various aspects of pranayama. These are compared to sacrificed by Krishna in this section. Then he concludes all this in the next verse, verse 30. Sarve pyete yajna vidho yajna chavita kalmashaha yajna shishtamurtam jo yanti brahma sanatanam. He says, Sarve pyete yajna vidho. All these people are knowers of yajna. Defining that word yajna in that wide sense, they are all knowers of yajna. Yajna chapita kanmashaha. Through yajna, they are purifying themselves of all evil. Yajna shishta amuta bhujo yanti brahma sanatanam. There is a concept in yajna that whatever food remains after the yajna is called consecrated food, taking which you become pure. Similarly, life becomes pure after all this yajna is being done, this type which we referred to earlier. Various types of yajnas we refer to here. So, yajna shishta amrita bhujo, yajna shishta amrita. What remains after yajna is called amrita, nectar, something immortal. That's the theory. In fact, in the Gita, third chapter, we read, first offer food to people, to some living beings, then you take yourself, that becomes a prasada, that becomes pure, that becomes elevating. What remains is meant for you, for making yourself pure. If you take yourself first, then that you are taking only so much of poison. Bhunjate te tvagham papa, e pajanti atmakaranat. That was the verse in the third chapter. Those who cook and eat first for themselves only, they eat only so much of sin. That's the language. Eat after others have been served, after others have been looked after. That becomes prasada. That becomes immortal. So in temples, we offer food to the Lord, and what remains we take as prasada. It's a beautiful concept, prasada, that which makes for mental peace and tranquility. Meaning of prasada means prasannata. Mind is tranquil. When you take pure food, mind is tranquil. And so, yajna shishta amrita bhujo, those who take food which remains after yajna or sacrifice is done, yanti brahma sanatanam, they reach Brahman, eternal reality. Sanatana means eternal. That is the way to go higher and higher in spiritual life, ethical life and moral life. So this is an emphasis in every religion, the idea of consecrated food, consecrated by giving to God, giving to God in the heart of other people, in the heart of all beings, including animals. Animals are included in our Vedantic tradition of yajna. So 30, said like this, verse 30 and 31 line says, Nayam loko syayajnasya kuto anya kurusattama. Arjuna, those who do not perform yajna of this type cannot achieve success even in this world. Na ayam loko, say, asti ayajnasya. Ayajna means one who does not perform yajna. To him or to her, even this world is not possible to be conquered. What to speak of the higher world? Kuto anya kurusattama. What about the other world? The world of higher spiritual life. How can you get that when you do not get even this? So that is the idea expressed by Krishna in this shloka, to stress that ethical behavior of you first, I next. That's meaning of ethical behavior. I am not first. You come first, I come later. What a beautiful concept. The concept of thou. The concept of I is always there, natural to us. But we have to change it. First thou, than I, then that I will be certainly a higher I. That is the meaning of ethical sense, the spirit of service, the spirit of dedication, through which you expand your personality, not at all confined to this tiny organic system. So this kind of expression is what ethics makes us develop in ourselves. So these verses, Krishna tells us that learn to put yourself second and put others first, then you get the best of life. That is a beautiful idea. Those who only say themselves all the time, they never achieve anything for themselves. Short term, they may do something, but long term, it will never be good to such people. That is the great message of ethics and spirituality. Because we are essentially one, this little I is not the main thing. It is only one point among millions of other points. It rescues itself when it recognizes the other points in other human beings. So, serve people, love people, take care of people, then you take care of yourself. That is the expression, the idea of selfishness, self-centeredness is to be overcome. That is the essential teaching of ethics, unless, I'm quoting the English poet Wordsworth, unless we erect ourselves above ourselves, how poor a thing is man. In that concept, you have the idea of man's ethical life, and in a society where millions of people live, we need to adopt this attitude, not I, but thou. Then what I get will be far superior than if I merely confine myself to me or I. And now comes verse 32, a very remarkable verse. Evam bahuvitha yajna vidata brahmano mukhe karmajan vidhitan sarvan evam jnatva vimokshase. This kind of yajna, many such yajnas are scattered in the Vedas. There are plenty of them in other scriptural books also. Evam bahuvitha yajna vidata, spread over, scattered, brahmano mukhe, in the books, the pages of the Vedas. Understand that all of them are the product of karma, karmajan. They are born of karma, a process. Okay. Karmajan, vidhi, sarvan, tan sarvan, all of them are the product of karma. Evam jnatva, knowing this, vimokshase, you will free yourself. That real knowledge will come, that these are all processes, these are all actions we do, and by understanding this truth, we become free from the bosom of the undifferentiated reality. Arise continually the processes of becoming. Being goes on into becoming. Remember, all becoming is ultimately being itself. All process is action, and all action is also Brahman. So this kind of equation is given in Vedanta. So, evam bahuvitha yajna vidata brahmano mukhe karmajan vidhitan sarvan evam jnatva vimokshase. Various yajnas like the above are strewn in the storehouse of the Vedas. Know them all to be born of action, and thus knowing, thou shalt be free. There. Now comes the comparison. Physical action, physical yajna, mental and spiritual yajna, these are compared in verse 33. Shreyan devyamayat yajnat jnana yajna parantapa sarvam karmakhilam partha jnane parisamatyate. That is a wonderful statement here. Knowledge sacrifice, jnana yajna, for Arjuna is far superior to material sacrifice performed with material objects. Jnana yajna is superior to karma yajna. That is the first statement here. Then comes the final statement. Sarvam karma akhilam partha jnane parisamapyate. All action, O Arjuna, attains its consummation in knowledge itself. Action becomes resolved into knowledge. Everything was knowledge. It becomes oriented to the world as action, and then it finally goes back to its own state as knowledge. So, sarvam karmakhilam partha jnane parisamapyate. That is a very important statement, that in every one of our actions you will find, when we study closely, there is mind behind it, there is knowledge behind it. That knowledge finds expression in various physical processes which we call action. But when you analyze them deeply, they are all nothing but the processes of the mind, which is called knowledge. Sarvam karma khilam partha jnane parisamapyate. All actions find their consummation in knowledge. This is the teaching. If that is so, this knowledge belongs to the self, our own infinite nature. Knowledge here doesn't mean book knowledge, academic knowledge, knowledge of the self, knowledge of the Atman, our own true self, which itself is of the nature of knowledge. It is of the nature of pure consciousness. All action, therefore, finds its emergence in this pure consciousness. Try to understand that truth, which is your own true nature. So in the next verse, in 34, you find this statement, Tadviddhi pranipatena pariprasnena sevaya upadekshyanti te jnanam jnaninas tattva darshanah. That great truth. What is the truth? All action finds their consummation in knowledge, in jnana. Know this truth, this knowledge, this Atman of the nature of pure consciousness. How? Pranipatena, by salutation. Pariprasnena, by constant questioning, critical inquiry. Pariprasnena, sevaya, by service. And that knowledge will be communicated to you by the teacher when he is satisfied that you are fit for receiving this knowledge. Upadekshanti te jnanam. Jnanina tattva darshinaha. Jnanis, that means those who have this jnana, they will give you this advice and this knowledge. And who are the jnanis? Tattva darshinaha, who have seen and realized the tattvam, the truth. In Sanskrit, the word tattvam exactly means the truth as it is, not what appears to us, but what is in it, what is it is in itself. Tasya bhava tattvam, Shankara comments. The real nature of the thing is called tattvam. How it appears to you is only your opinion. But this is not opinion, this is truth as it is. Therefore it is called tattvam. Those who have realized this tattvam, they are the jnanis. They will impart this knowledge to you. So try to get this knowledge. And the method given here is three. Pranipatena, pariprasnena, sevaya. A great person has a fund of knowledge. I want to get something out of it. What do? First I go and salute him. Then I begin to question him. And I also serve him to show my humility before the great knowledge that he represents. So three items are mentioned here. Generally we do it in all higher education. May not be literally in the same way, but a student has respect to a teacher who teaches science, that respect, science expression in acts and modes of reverence to the teacher and the knowledge he represents, and then constant questioning. In the Vedantic tradition, this questioning has a tremendous place. It's not belief. If it is only a dogma that is communicated, there is no place for questioning there. Only belief, nothing but belief. Accept whatever is said by the teacher. But where truth is concerned, you need lot of questioning. Is it true? Is it true? Again and again, you have to ask that question. So the Gita refers to here, not only to questioning, but continuous questioning, repeated questioning. Pariprasnena, you must fully come up, understand the truth, what is conveyed, all aspects of it. So the more critical your mind, the better will be your reception. I don't think in many religious teachings you will find this honored place for questioning as you find in Vedanta, only because Vedanta is sure it is conveying a profound truth to the student. And that truth can stand any amount of questioning. In fact, truth shines only through such questioning. That is the emphasis in Vedanta. The Upanishads, the Gita, and several other books. Buddha and Sri Ramakrishna in our own time, they all emphasized this questioning. Sri Ramakrishna told Swami Vivekananda, many of us, Narendra, his disciple, question me, test me, as the money changers test their coins. Don't accept simply because I say so. Earlier, 2500 years ago, Buddha said the same thing to his disciples. Don't accept whatever I tell you. Try to examine, try to question, find out whether it is true. And if you are fully satisfied, then only you accept it, live it, communicate it to others. Don't accept it because it is said in a book, it is said in a doctrine, or by a church. Never accept such things, always question. Now that is the Vedantic tradition in India. Wherever there is this Vedantic approach, you will find the stress on questioning. Where it is not there, then it is all dogma, doctrine and belief. And questioning is prohibited. Questioning means you are considered to be absolutely unfit for that particular religion. So that is one side. Here, you have that scientific approach. For truth has no fear of questioning. Truth invites questioning. Vedanta has to convey to you some profound truth about yourself, that you are not this tiny organic system. There's a profound spiritual dimension within you. Try to realize this truth for yourself. That is conveyed in a small statement of the Chandogya Upanishad by the father, teacher, to his son, disciple. Tattvamasi, tattvamasi. You are that. You are that. You are not this creaturely individual. Not this organic system. You are something infinite, divine. That is your true nature. Now that is the truth conveyed by Vedanta. And they want people, Vedanta wants people to understand it and live it. We are not this tiny organic system. We are greater. We are infinite in our nature. We are ever pure. As Shankaracharya puts it, Nitya Shuddha Buddha Mukta Svabhava. You are Nitya Shuddha, ever pure. Nitya Buddha, ever awake. Nitya Shuddha, ever pure. And Nitya Mukta, ever free. That is the true nature of man, according to Vedanta. And this has been tested and verified by hundreds of people throughout history. So it can stand scrutiny today in our scientific age. Let us approach it from that scientific angle of questioning. Gita will say later on in a beautiful verse, it already said it also here and there, that hundreds and thousands of people have realized this truth by changing the structure of their mind, the nature of their sensory system. By properly disciplining all this, they could realize this truth. We are the infinite Atman. We are ever free, ever pure. Vitaraga bhayakrodha manmaya mam upashyataha bahavo jnana tapasa pota madbhava magata. Krishna is telling, bahavo, many, many people have achieved me, become one with me. How? Jnana tapasa pota. Then they became purified by the austerity of jnana, austerity of spiritual knowledge. Then they realized me. How many? Bahavo, hundreds and thousands have realized this truth. It's not something new. But what kind of training they gave to themselves? Vitaraga bhayakrodha. When they overcame the pressures of their inner emotions, three types of them, raga, bhaya, krodha, sensory attachment, fear, and anger. Overcome these three. See the emphasis on fear. Only in Vedanta you find fear as treated as an evil, not a virtue. Fearlessness alone is virtue. That is a great emphasis. Overcome fear, overcome fear. Religion is not a religion of fear. It is a religion of fearlessness. From the Upanishads up to Swami Vivekananda in our own time, you find this constant emphasis on fearlessness as the essence of moral life, as the way to spiritual development. So, Veta Raga Bhaya Krodha, attachment, fear, anger, overcome them. Manmaya, then your mind becomes drawn to the highest, to the divine. That is myself, Krishna says, as the incarnation of the divine. Manmaya, mam upashritaha, depending upon me, that infinite reality, that is your own true nature. Bahavo, many such people, jnana tapasapota, purified by the tapas of jnana, have come unto me. Madbhava magataha. That is a wonderful statement in the Gita. So here also, this kind of jnana can be realized by service of the teacher, constant questioning of the teacher, and also salutations to the teacher. We salute the knowledge represented in the teacher. All salutation is that something that person has, which is great and which I seek. Therefore I salute. The child salutes the parents. What a beautiful conception. A student salutes the teacher. There is something in the teacher the student is seeking. And so he shows respect to that something. So that is the emphasis here. Tadvidhi pranipatena pariprasnena sevaya upadekshanti te jnanam jnaninaha. Those jnanis who have realized this truth, they will convey this to you. They have realized the truth because tattva darshinaha, they have realized tattvam. In Sanskrit, as I said just before, tattvam means thing as it is, truth as it is. The opposite of it is matam, opinion. This is my opinion. This is my preference. There is plenty of place for preferences in human life. I prefer this food. I prefer this cloth. There is no standard rule for any such thing. That is one aspect of human life. But when it comes to the truth of things, there is no question of preference. Prefer what is true. Therefore the word tattvam comes there. That is a tattvam. What food you like? I like this. I like that. That's my matam, my opinion, my preference, my prejudice, you may say. So far as food is concerned, then what is the tattvam about it? Whatever food you take, see you are nourished. That is the tattvam regarding food. So nourishment is the principle. Whether it comes through this type of food, that type of food, doesn't matter. So that is matam, this is tattvam. Life is full of matam and tattvam. We must emphasize what is what. We should not convert matam into tattvam, then fanaticism will come. Tattvam into matam, then also trouble will come. We must see tattvam as tattvam, matam as matam, and both have place in human life. This distinction Vedanta came across very early in the history, in the Upanishad. Later on, Shankaracharya also clarified it by saying that human truths and preferences are classified into two. One is called Vastu Tantram, the other is called Purusha Tantram. In his commentary on the sutras of Badarayana, Brahma Sutras, in the introduction itself, Shankaracharya says in the first four sutras that knowledge belongs to two categories, Vastu Tantra Jnanam, knowledge of things as they are, that's called Vastu Tantra Jnanam. The other is Purusha Tantra Jnanam, knowledge of things as we want them to be, according to our own preference, like food and dress, as I said earlier. But is God Purusha Tantra Jnanam or Vastu Tantra Jnanam? Shankara says, God, as taught in Vedanta, is Vastu Tantra Jnanam, based upon the Vastu, knowledge based upon the existing Vastu. Just like fire is hot, it is the Vastu Tantra Jnanam. Similarly, Brahman, the ultimate reality, is Vastu Tantra Jnanam, because you cannot alter it, you cannot change it, you cannot abolish it, you have to simply recognize the truth of it. Matartum, agartum, anitha agartum, shakyate. You can't change it, you can't alter it, you can't abolish it, because it's the truth. Just recognize it, that's good for you. That is the nature of Vastu Tantra Jnanam. The other is Purusha Tantra Jnanam. Depending upon the preferences of the individual concerned, jnanam or knowledge based upon one's own personal preferences, that can be abolished, that can be changed, that can be altered according to your own sweet will. Today I shall eat this food, tomorrow I shall eat some other food. There's no question at all. It's up to your own liking. So in this way, Shankaracharya recognized God and the human soul are Vastu Tantra Jnana. That infinite reality of the universe is in me as the self, as the Atman, the spark of the divine. This and that are one. The Atman in me, the Atman in you, and the Atman of the universe, they are one and the same. Pure consciousness is always a single. There is no plurality in consciousness, says Schrodinger, the famous nuclear scientist. Vedanta expounded it ages ago. If you find differences, it is because you see consciousness through various media. This individual, that individual, so many differences you find. Like space, which is indivisible. When you put a wall around, you make space limited by the wall and you call it a room. But space itself doesn't know any difference at all. Space inside, outside is only one. But for our purpose, we limit it. As space is indivisible, but looks like being divided, so is Atman, indivisible, looks being divided here and there. That infinite Atman, that is our nature, that's the nature of this universe. That is the central theme of Vedanta. That is the basis of the ethical and spiritual teaching of the Gita, the true nature of every human being. You are the Atman. No fire can burn you. No water can wet you. No weapons can cut you. You are deathless, immortal. In the second chapter, Krishna started his teaching by communicating this profound truth, not an opinion, but a truth which you can check up and realize for yourself. You can, if possible, abolish it, disprove it if you can. But so far, nobody has been able to disprove this truth. They have realized the truth. If they couldn't prove it, only because they have not put forth enough effort. Their laboratory conditions were not clear. Therefore, they couldn't realize this truth. But those who have tried sincerely, they have realized this truth. And hundreds and thousands have realized it. They belong to all dimensions of society, from the mighty to the ordinary. Because truth can be realized by proper approach to that subject. So that is the उपदेक्षन्ति ते ज्ञानम् ज्ञानिनः तत्त्वदर्शिनः. देन कृष्णा सेज यज्ञात्वा न पुनर्मोहम् एवं यास्यति पांडव येन भूतान्यशेषेण द्रक्ष्यस्यात्मन्यथो मयि. Once you realize this truth, something great will happen to you, says Krishna. You will never again be deluded. When you have true knowledge, no delusion can come near. The absence of knowledge is what makes for delusion. Till now we are deluded, and now you have the knowledge with you. So yajñātvā, knowing which, na punarmoham evam, this kind of delusion that has come upon you, you will never have it again. Yasisi Pandava, yena bhūtāni aśeṣena drakṣasi ātmani, by which you will see all beings established in your own self, and atho mayi, and also in me, as the infinite self of all, as the incarnation divine, to see the universe in oneself, in one's infinite Atman, not this tiny little ego controlled by the organic system, but the infinite self in which the whole universe is. That is Vedantic teaching. The universe has come from the self. The universe exists in the self. It goes back to the self. That self or Atman is also known as Brahman, the infinite, the absolute reality. See everything in and through the Atman. The Atman is everything. If the world has come from the Atman, everything in the world is in the Atman, cannot be outside the Atman. Behind the cosmos, there is this infinite Atman. Cosmos has come from the Atman. Everything in the cosmos is touched by the Atman. As I said earlier about the solar radiation touching everything in this solar system, so also is the universe with respect to the Atman. Yena bhutani asheshena, completely all beings in the world will be seen in the Atman and in me, the infinite Atman whose incarnation I am, as Shri Krishna, as he had said at the beginning of this chapter. Now he says, api chetasi papebhya sarvebhya papakrittamaha sarvam jnanaplaveneiva prijinam santarishyasi. The wonderful praise of knowledge, jnana being praised. In praise of jnana we can call it. Just like in English there is a poem, in praise of folly. Here there is in praise of jnana. Series of verses dealing with jnana. Jnana alone can destroy bondages. That is the truth. And so he says, even if one is the greatest sinner, api chedasi papebhya sarvebhya papa krittamaha, the maximum papa or sin you have done, even if you have done so, with this jnana, we can cross all that ocean of sin. Such is the power of jnana. Even if you be the most sinful among all the sinful people, yet by this knowledge you can cross the ocean of sin and go to the other shore of purity and sinlessness. Here jnana is compared to a ship, a raft. It is jnana plava. You get into the jnana boat, you cross the ocean of sin. That is what Krishna expresses here. It is also compared to fire. It will come later on. Fire burns away all wood. Similarly, all sins are burned away by the fire of knowledge. That comparison also is given. So, people who are sinful, there is no fear. There is something in the human being which is free from all sin all the time. Even if the body-mind complex is full of sin, the infinite Atman within is untouched by sin. Because of that one focus of sinlessness, there is hope for everyone to cross this ocean of sin. We studied this at the end of chapter 3, the last 7 verses when Krishna discussed the subject of the genesis of crime in society, how to overcome crime. And there he said, crime and sin can infect only the body, the senses, and the mind of man. It can never infect the Atman that is ever there, always pure and holy. Therefore, taking hold of the Atman, we shall destroy the sin that has come on the rest of the system. That is the language that was used in the third chapter. Here, that is re-emphasized. Apichedasa pavebhya sarvebhya papakrittamaha sarvam jnanaplaveneiva vrijinam santarishyasi. Vrijinam means sin. Through the jnanaplava, we cross the ocean of all sin. This is a beautiful idea. So far as sin is concerned, Vedanta accepts that people do commit sin. But Vedanta does not accept that a human being is a sinner. Human being is a child of God, child of immortality, ever pure. But not knowing the truth, we commit sin. But when you know the truth, you will never commit sin again. When you walk in darkness, you can fall into a pit. But when there is enough light, you won't fall into pit at all. So knowledge is praised for that purpose here. As one of our philosophers said, Dr. Radhakrishnan, every sinner has a future and every saint had a past. It's a wonderful expression. Those who are saints today were at one time doing sin, but they overcame it. They became saints. So a sinner has a future. That must be constantly emphasized. And so this verse 36 referred to this idea, all can be saved. That redemption of man is built into man himself or herself. It is built in there, our own pure nature, infinite nature. We have to take recourse to it, try to bring it to bear upon our day-to-day life. It may be a long journey, but it's a sure journey. We shall reach the other shore. That assurance is given in many books of Vedanta, particularly now in this verse. Then verse 37 says, example, exactly as I said, fire becomes the example here. Yathai dham sisamidhokne basmasat kurate arjuna jnanatni savagammani basmasat kurate patha. Like fire, which burns away, blazing fire, a pile of wood in no time. Similarly, the fire of jnana burns away all evil. Sarvakarmani, all actions, good, bad, everything is burned away by this fire of jnana. That is the most important thing, lighting the fire of jnana within the system. How many evil deeds can be burned away? Evil tendencies can be burned away. So the greatest emphasis in Vedanta is light the fire of knowledge, jnana agni. Just like jataragni, digestive fire in the stomach, can digest all food, most heavy foods even. Similarly, fire of knowledge can destroy all evil and all sin. That fire of knowledge has to be lit, has to be lit up in every one of us. That is a true education. Like fire of stomach, we try to retain. We do want strong digestive system. But let it not be merely physical, but also spiritual digestive fire must also be lit up here. And finally, the last shloka comes in this particular section. Nahi jnanena sadasyam pavitram iha vidyate tatsvayam yogasansiddha kalena atmani vindati. There is nothing so purifying as jnana in this world. Tatsvayam yogasansiddha kalena atmani vindati. When I enter the path of yoga, as taught in the Gita, converting all action into a spiritual direction, then you achieve it here and now, in this very life, this jnana, this spiritual knowledge, this spiritual realization. This particular statement, nahi jnanena sadasyam, was adopted as a motto of the Mysore University in the 1917 or so, when it started. Nothing so purifying as jnana. It's a beautiful, beautiful motto for all education. Nahi jnanena tadrisham pavitram iha vidyate tatsvayam yogasam siddha kalena atmarimindati. In course of time, it matures and matures, ultimately makes for freedom of the individual. That jnana begins like a small fire, later on burns up into a blazing fire, destroying all evil within us. Be assured of this truth, says Krishna in this sloka. We shall take up the remaining verses and some verses of the next chapter 9 next time when we meet here.